Hey, I am so excited to be here this morning because last week we started a sermon series that we called Animal Planet. And Scott taught us how God created the heavens and the earth. We learned how he separated the land from the water. But we also learned that on the fifth day of creation, God decided to make the first living things. But the first living things that God made weren't people. The first living things that God created were animals. Look at what the Bible says in Genesis 1:20. Then God said, "Let the water be filled with living creatures, and let birds fly across the sky." So Scripture tells us that on the fifth day that God created two very specific kinds of animals. He created birds, and he created fish. So God made animals like the leafy sea dragon and the red-lipped batfish. But he also created owls and eagles, parrots and penguins. And God designed these birds in such a way that they could fly with ease. But this morning, we're going to do something that we've never done before. Because today, I'm going to take all of you on an amazing adventure. This morning, we are going to go to the Lake of Gennesaret. And the reason that we're going to the Lake of Gennesaret is because it's a place where Jesus changed a man's entire life. But you see, Jesus didn't change this man's life by healing him from a disease. No, Jesus changed this man's entire life by using a bunch of animals. But in order for this to make sense, I need to take a minute to explain what the Lake of Gennesaret was really like. See, the Lake of Gennesaret is located in the northern part of Israel. And this body of water is huge. It's 13 miles long and 8 miles wide. Now, even though this lake is really, really big, people in the Bible would go there all the time. They went to the lake to get water to drink because, see, they didn't have faucets in their house like we do. They went there to take a bath because they didn't have showers or bathtubs in the Bible. But they also went to the Lake of Gennesaret to go to work. You see, one of the most common jobs in the Bible was being a fisherman. And there were hundreds of men who went to the Lake of Gennesaret every day to catch fish. Because that's how they earned a living. What they would do is they would go out on a boat and they would catch as many fish as they could. And then they would sell all of those fish for money so that they could feed their family. Now, the most common type of fish that they would catch at Lake Gennesaret was the tilapia. And the tilapia is a small freshwater fish that had these super long dorsal fins. And history tells us that the tilapia is one of the most popular fish of all time. In fact, there are even records that King Tut loved eating tilapia more than any other kind of fish. But see, you also need to know that fishing at the Lake of Gennesaret was dangerous. Because this lake was known to have furious storms that would just come out of nowhere. And if you were out on a boat when one of these storms hit, you were in big trouble. Because huge waves would come crashing over the side of your boat and people would be swept overboard into the water. It was a dangerous place. But one day, while Jesus was at the Lake of Gennesaret, something really interesting happened. Look at what the Bible says in Luke chapter 5, verse 1. One day, as Jesus was standing by the Lake of Gennesaret, a crowd was pushing in on him to better hear the word of God. So the Bible tells us that one day Jesus was at the Lake of Gennesaret, and there are a ton of people all around him. And do you know why all these people were surrounding Jesus and pushing in on him? It's because Jesus was telling all of them how much God really loved them. And they had never heard that before. In fact, these people were so excited to hear what Jesus was saying that they were pressing in to get close to him as close as they could. So Jesus kind of looked up and down the shoreline and he saw two fishing boats. And so do you know what he did? Jesus walked over to one of the fishermen, whose name was Simon, and he asked Simon if he could use the boat to teach this huge crowd of people all about God's love. But that leads us to ask a really important question. Why would Jesus do that? Why would Jesus get into a boat to teach people about God? Well, Jesus did that because he was really smart. And let me tell you why. You see, at this time in history, there was no such thing as microphones or speakers. There was no such thing as a sound system. But Jesus knew something about science. He knew that if you're out on a lake, your voice can reflect off the water and carry towards shore. It's kind of like how light reflects off a mirror. Let me show you what I'm talking about. If I take a mirror and a flashlight, and I shine the light on the mirror, oh no, there we go. You can see the light bounces up onto the ceiling. But if I change the direction of the light, I'm gonna try really hard not to blind anybody in the back, but if I work it just right, I can get the light to shine on the back wall of the auditorium because the light reflects off the mirror and goes all the way to the back of the room. And interestingly enough, your voice will do the same thing on water because your voice will reflect off the water and carry towards shore. In fact, one of the things that people still do today on vacation at Lake Gennesaret is they'll have someone take them out on the water, and when they get out there, the tour guide will tell them, okay, somebody come to the front of the boat, and I just want you to speak in a normal voice. And everybody's like, well, what's going on? And you speak in a normal voice, and all the people on shore can hear every word that you say. Even though you're not like shouting or anything, you're just speaking in a normal voice. And Jesus knew this. So he gets into a boat and Simon rows Jesus out into the water so that everyone can hear what Jesus has to say about God's love. But I want you to see what Jesus did after he finished teaching. Look at what the Bible says in verse 4. When Jesus had finished speaking, he said to Simon, "Put out into the deep water and let your nets down for a catch." Now, this is weird. It really is. Because, you see, Scripture tells us that after Jesus told all these people how much God loved them, he looked at Simon and he said, "Okay, what I want you to do is I want you to row out into the deep water, throw your nets in, and let's catch some fish." And do you know why this was so weird? This was weird because Simon already knew how to catch fish. Simon was a professional fisherman. But you see, Simon didn't catch fish the way that we do today. Because when we think about catching fish, we end up using one of these. A fishing pole. And we put a hook and a bobber on our pole. And that's the way that most of us fish. We go out to the lake, we cast in, and we wait for our bobber to show that, oh, I got a bite, and then we reel like crazy, and am I stuck? Tommy, help me out. There we go, I caught a big one, so big that it got stuck, and we reel like crazy, and, oh, that's about the size fish I usually catch. But in the Bible, they didn't have poles. And that's not how Simon fished. Because if you were a fisherman in the first century, you didn't use a pole. You used a great big fishing net. But to show you how this really worked, I actually need 4 volunteers. Okay, over here in the third row on the end, right there. And then how about you right here? Come on up. And right here in the front row. And right back there in the third row. Yep, come on up. All right, you guys, come on over here. We're going to turn this light on so everybody can see us. Okay, so what they used... All right, 2 of you are going to be in a boat over here. All right, come on right over here. Hi, I'm Joel. What's your name?
Kendall.
Kendall, it's nice to meet you, Kendall. Where do you go to school?
Atoka.
Say that again.
Atoka.
Atoka, okay. Great to meet you. Hi, what's your name?
CJ.
CJ, nice to meet you, CJ. Where do you go to school?
Ridge.
All right, give it up for Ridge. And hi, you are?
Penny.
Penny, nice to meet you, Penny. I'm Joel. Where do you go to school, Penny?
Cornerstone.
And your boyfriend's name is? Oh, you don't have, that's good. Boys are nothing but trouble. Stay away from them for as long as you can. And come on down here so everybody can see you turn so people can see you. And your name is?
Jake.
It's nice to meet you, Jake. Shake my hand. There you go. Shake it like you mean it. There you go. Good job. Where do you go to school, Jake?
Orchard Hollow.
Orchard Hollow? I've never heard of that before. It sounds like an awesome school, though. All right, here we go. This is our fishing net. And what they would do is they would use two boats. So they would fish in teams. And so you guys are going to be team one. Penny, hold the very top of it. Jake, kind of grab it in the middle there, and I want you guys to take a step that way just a little bit. There you go. Stretch that net out. All right, now we're going to make our net a little bit shorter, so I want you guys to kind of grab it right here. Okay, there you go, Kendall. And then CJ, grab that. Now stretch it tight. Okay, you guys kind of back up a little bit. And then what we would do is they'd have two boats, and they would sink the net down into the water. There would be weights on the bottom of it, and they would stretch it tight. And then, okay, we need a fish. Where's my fish at? Come on down, buddy. This is my little guy, Brayton. He's going to be our fish today. And so what would happen is the boats, after they stretched the net tight, they would start rowing in a circle as fast as they could, going in opposite directions around the circle. So CJ and Kendall, you guys are going to start moving this way around our little lake here. You guys are going to move in the other direction, go towards them. And so the fish would get tangled up in the net. Now, Jake and Penny, drop your net down to the ground, kind of hold on to it. You guys are going to step over. What the boats would do is they would relax the ropes on the net so that one boat could sail over the net. Go ahead and step over. Be real careful here, okay? You're going to step right over. Yep, perfect. And you too, Kendall, come on. There you go. All right, good job. Nobody got hurt. That was my number one concern. Now keep holding on to your net. Okay, now you guys keep going that way. And then they would continue to row. Keep going, keep going, keep going. And the fish would get all tangled up in the net. And then they would come in close and they would drag the nets up out of the water onto the boat. This is why I'm using my kid. And they would drop it onto the net, onto the deck. And then they would have to sort the fish out of the net and do it all over again. And again, and again. All right, good job, everybody. Let me get my fish untangled here. You guys stay right there for a second. All right, bud, come on, jump up. There we go. All right, go back to mom. Good job. For the rest of you fishermen, I've got some bait for you for the next time you go. Here's some worms for you to put on your fishing pole. All right. Everybody give them a big round of applause. Good job, everybody. Okay, so that's the first way that people fished in the first century. But the second way that people fished in the first century was a little bit different. Instead of using two boats, they would just use a single boat. And what they would do is they would tie a weight into the net, and they would tie the four corners of the net with a big long rope, four long ropes. They would throw the net overboard and let it sink down to the bottom of the lake. And then when it was all the way down, they'd kind of row a little ways away till the nets, the ropes were nice and taut. And then they would pull as fast as they could on the ropes. And what would happen is the net would kind of curl in like a parachute. And they would pull the net through the water, and any fish that were swimming by would get caught up in the net. And then they would drag that big net up out of the water into the boat, sort it all out, and then throw it back in and do it over and over again. Fishing was really, really hard work. So now that you understand what fishing was really like, let's go back to our story. The Bible tells us that when Jesus finished teaching, he looked to Simon and he said, "What I want you to do is go out into the deep water and throw your nets over, and let's catch some fish." But Simon didn't want to do it. And do you know why he didn't want to do it? The Bible tells us in verse 5. Simon answered, "Master, we've worked hard all night, and we haven't caught anything. But because you say so, I will let down the nets." Now, isn't that odd? See, Scripture tells us that Simon didn't want to let the nets down because he'd already fished all night, and he hadn't caught anything. As far as Simon, this professional fisherman, could tell, there were no fish in that part of the lake on that day. But because Jesus asked him to give it a try, Simon said, "Okay, Jesus, I will let down the nets for you." And I want you to see what happened in verse 6. When they had done so, they caught so many fish that their nets began to break. So they signaled their partners in the other boat to come and help them. And they came and filled both boats so full that they began to sink. Now, this was completely unreal because the Bible tells us these guys caught so many fish that their nets started to break. And this is the part of the story that is so amazing that we can't just read about it. I want you to see how crazy this really was. So I need 3 more volunteers. Okay, right here in the front. Thank you, right there. All right, over there. Yep, come on up. And one more from over here. All right, over here on the side in the front. Come on up, guys. Thank you, guys. All right, so we're going to toss our net to the side here real quick. Hi, I'm Joel. What's your name?
Mia.
Mia, it's nice to meet you, Mia. Where do you go to school?
Fairfax.
And what's your boyfriend's name? Oh, she's silent. She doesn't want to say. Hi, I'm Joel. What's your name?
Autumn.
What grade are you in, Autumn?
Kindergarten.
So my little guy's going to be in kindergarten next year. That's awesome. And you are?
Leanne.
Lane. Nice to meet you, Lane. I'm Joel. Where do you go to school?
Bellflower.
All right. So, Mia, I'm going to have you be Simon. So I want you to come stand right here. You two are going to be Simon's partners in the other boat, so just come stand right over here. And so, Simon, here's your boat. I know it looks a little small, but it'll make sense in a minute here. All right, and you two are Simon's partners. Hold the boat together, and then you all get a fishing net. And so, Simon, here's your fishing net, same size as your boat. And then each of you, there you go. All right, so stand here so everybody can see you. Come turn this way a little bit, okay? Hold your boat so they can see your boat and both of you guys with your fishing nets. Okay, so what we're going to do is we're going to start the story up again. Simon, you're going to say, "Because you say so, I will let down the nets." Okay? And then we're going to read those verses again and see what really happened. Okay? All right, but first, I need you to actually get in the lake, right? Because you're fishing. So go ahead and get in the lake. All right, and you guys wait for a second, and then we'll bring you in the lake in just a second. Okay, so Simon, go ahead. Say your line, "Because you say so, I will let down the nets."
I will let down the nets.
All right, let your net out. And when they had done so, their nets were filled with so many fish that they began to break. So they signaled to their partners, "Come on, get in, help out." And when they came, they were so full that the ships began to sink. It was crazy. There were fish everywhere. It was the most amazing thing they'd ever seen. Sorry about the fish in your hair. Great job, you guys. You can just drop your nets into our lake, and you can put your boats down there, too. Thank you. And since you are such amazing fishermen, I also have some worms for you for the next time that you go fishing. Great job. Everybody give a big round of applause. All right. Could you imagine what that must have been like? I know that was silly, but really, it was incredible. Can you imagine being in a boat with so many fish that your boat starts to sink? I mean, what would you be thinking? Most of us would be happy. I mean, after all, we just caught more fish than we could have dreamed of. We could sell those fish and make a fortune. We could be set for life. But do you know something interesting? The interesting thing is that Simon wasn't happy at all. See, Simon was scared. And do you know why Simon was scared? He was afraid because he felt like he wasn't good enough to be around Jesus. You see, Simon was someone who'd made some mistakes in his life. He did some things that he shouldn't have done. He told some lies that he shouldn't have told. And because Simon felt like he wasn't good enough, he said to Jesus, "Go away from me, Lord. I am a sinful man." You see, Simon felt really bad about the things that he'd done wrong in his life because he thought that the only people God really loved were the ones who'd never made a mistake. And Simon knew that he wasn't one of those people. So he said to Jesus, "Look, you need to go away from me. I'm not a good person." But you see, that's not what Jesus thought. Jesus didn't think that Simon was a bad person. Jesus thought that Simon was someone who had a lot of potential. And that's why Jesus said, "Don't be afraid." Don't be afraid. It's almost like Jesus was saying, "Look, Simon, I know you've done some things that you shouldn't have done, but that doesn't mean that God doesn't love you. That doesn't mean that you're not a good person. God loves you more than you will ever know." And you see, that one event changed Simon's life forever. Because instead of spending every day wondering if he would ever be good enough for God, Simon spent the rest of his life following Jesus. And he did some of the most amazing things ever written in the Bible. But you see, do you know what it took for Simon to learn that lesson? It took some animals. God used a bunch of fish to help Simon understand how much God really loved him. And can I tell you something? God thinks the very same thing of you and of me. Because, see, God doesn't want us to feel like we aren't good enough or smart enough, and he doesn't want us to be afraid of him. He wants us to know just how much he loves us. And so to help you remember this lesson, everyone in Kid City today will be getting two things. The first thing we have for you is a fish. Now, Scott wanted to give all of you a live goldfish, but he was afraid that he'd get too many emails from your parents. So what we have for you instead are some Swedish fish. Because we want them to remind you that every time you see a fish, you should think of this story. It should remind you that you don't have to be afraid of God, because God is not mad at you. God loves you. The second thing that we have for you is a feather pen like this one. Pretty cool, huh? And on the pen, it has our memory verse. It says Luke 5:10. "Then Jesus said to Simon, 'Don't be afraid.'" And so we want you to use your pen to write that down so that you will always remember that you don't have to be afraid of God, because God loves you. So we're going to stand up and practice our memory verse a couple times. Everybody, adults too. And so we've got a couple small hand motions to go with this. It goes like this. We're going to say Luke 5:10. "Then Jesus said to Simon, 'Don't be afraid.'" All right, let's try it again. Luke 5:10. "Then Jesus said to Simon, 'Don't be afraid.'" All right, let me pray for us. Father God, thank you that you are willing to use things like fish to show us just how much you love us. Thank you that we don't have to be afraid that you're mad at us, because as you told Simon, don't be afraid. You love us more than we can possibly imagine. And I pray today that everyone would remember that, that in those moments when we're worried about the things that we've done, that we would simply turn to you and remember that you love us and that you are always there for us, and we don't have to be afraid. In Jesus' name.